Bibles, I'd like you to turn to Ephesians chapter 1. And we have been looking at this hymn that Paul starts this letter to the Ephesians to. And remember that Ephesians 1, 3 through 14 is a doxology, a hymn of praise to the Trinity. And we've talked about Paul's greeting to the Ephesian church, verses 1 and 2. And then he sings a hymn of praise of three verses. Praise to the Father, verses 3 through 6. Praise to the Son, verses 7 through 12. And now praise to the Holy Spirit, verses 13 and 14. And each verse ends with a similar phrase, to the praise of His glorious grace, or for the praise of His glory. Look with me as we read in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of His glory. Now today we come to this third verse, which is praise to the Spirit. And we said earlier that the Father initiates salvation. The Son gave His life for our salvation. And now Paul praises the Holy Spirit for guaranteeing our salvation. And as we look at this passage today, I want you to remember this. The Holy Spirit seals our salvation the moment we put our faith and trust in Jesus as our Savior. The Holy Spirit seals us. And that's a special anointing that He gives. That's a special matter that means a lot in the matters of salvation, because it means that we are secure in God's family because of this seal. So let's look at this whole salvation experience and then ask ourselves how the Holy Spirit is involved. The Father initiates. The Lord Jesus gave His life so we might have salvation. He was raised again to give us eternal life. And now the Spirit comes to guarantee our salvation. So what is the individual's role in salvation? That's a big question we want to ask ourselves today. What do we have that's involved in this matter of salvation? You know, there are some that say salvation is only of the Lord, that only God does it. Well, yes, that's true, because salvation comes from the Lord. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's that, not of yourselves, it's not of works, that no one should boast. So it comes by God's grace. But that doesn't mean that we're zeros, that we don't have a part in it. We do have a part in it. God extends His grace as a gift, and we need to accept it and receive it by faith to make it our own. So we do have a part in salvation. Look at verse 13 again. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of the truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Now, Paul is very specific in his terminology here. It's very important what he says, and I want you to make note of these words that he uses, because each one has a specific aspect to it that enhances our understanding of our salvation. Notice, first of all, that salvation is for all people. Salvation is for all people. We talked about earlier about the subject of election. And it wasn't that some are elected to be saved and some are elected to be damned. No, all were elected to be saved, but only some choose to agree with it. Only some choose to follow the Lord. Only some choose to accept this free gift of salvation. And so before the foundation of the world, God had a plan. That plan was that in Christ, we would receive salvation and become part of His family. And everyone has that opportunity. Everyone has that choice. And so we need to be very clear that salvation is for all people. That's why Paul says, and you also were included in Christ. Notice that in verse 12, he had mentioned earlier, in order that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be for the praise of His glory. Who was the we Paul was talking about in verse 12? He was talking about the Jewish people. The gospel first came to them, didn't it? And they had an opportunity to choose and believe and receive, and some did. Some accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, as the Messiah. And now Paul says, and you also were included in Christ. Amen. And so God opened it up, and Paul was the missionary to the Gentiles, and he was spreading this good news that everyone can be saved. Amen. Salvation is for all people. Yes. Doesn't matter what your background, your nationality, doesn't matter what your education is, what your monetary status is. It doesn't matter, and none of that matters. Amen. Everyone can be saved. All people have that opportunity of salvation. And so Paul says, hey, you Ephesians, you were included as well as us Jewish people. Now, Paul goes on. He says that faith comes by hearing the word of truth in the gospel. That's where we get our faith. It comes by hearing the word of truth that's in the gospel. Paul goes on and says, when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Now, notice the way it progresses here. You heard it, this message that was preached, and it's the good news of salvation. And so, when you heard the message, that gave you this idea that God loves me, He cares for me. He sent His Son to die for me, to give His life for me. And when you heard that message, you received it and accepted it as the truth. And in that moment, you were saved. Now, God gave you that grace. God gave you that faith to hear the word and to receive it as the truth in the gospel. Romans 10:17 says exactly the same thing. Notice what Paul writes there. Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. Amen. It's exactly what Paul says back here in Ephesians, that you have to have faith. But you only get faith when you hear the word, when it's preached, when it's told, when it's shared. You know, we pray over and over, God save the lost. God, please bring salvation to those who don't know Jesus. But you know, we're missing out on something here. How are they going to hear unless they have a preacher, Paul asked? How are they going to hear unless someone tells them? How are they going to know the truth that will set them free unless you and I share it? And so Paul's very clear here. You got to tell the message. You got to share the message, because that's where the Holy Spirit builds up faith in a person to come to a place where they receive it as the truth. Amen. Jesus did everything He needed to do. The Father did everything He needed to do. And the Holy Spirit's just waiting to do what He needs to do. But the message has to be told. And when someone hears that message, Paul says, by faith, they come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. So faith comes by hearing the word of truth in the gospel. But then he goes on and he says that we must believe in a person, Jesus Christ, for salvation. It's not enough just to hear it. It's not enough just to believe it, but we have to put action to it. We need to believe and receive. We need to accept it as our own. We need to personalize it. So when he uses this phrase here, that we are to believe, what he's saying is that we had to take action and act upon what we heard. Notice, it says, when you believed, you were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the seal. Amen. And you are marked in Christ when you believe. What is belief? Belief is just simply agreeing that what God says is true, is true. Amen. You accept it as a fact. You put your faith and hope in that message. And you trust that it's true. But it's more than just an intellectual message, a list of 1, 2, 3 steps. No, it's about a person. It's about this man named Jesus. And you hear this story, the old story we sing about. And the story is that God loved us so much that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. That God loved us. He sent His Son. Jesus died on the cross for us in our place. He forgave our sins. He covered our sins. God raised Him from the grave. And now he has the authority to give us eternal life.
Amen.
That's the message. That's it in a nutshell. And when we put our faith and trust in Jesus, who made that message possible, that's when we are saved. We must believe in a person, Jesus Christ, for our salvation. Now, Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 13 say the exact same thing. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it's with your heart that you believe and are justified. It's with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved.
Amen.
Amen. It's very clear here. You believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. You believe it. You believe that message is true. That Jesus isn't somebody who's buried in a tomb somewhere. He really was risen from the grave on the third day after he died for our sins.
Yes,
and so you believe that in your heart. And then you proclaim it. You tell others and say, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. He is my Lord, he is my King, and I am going to follow him. And when you do that, you confirm what's already in your heart. And God makes you right in his sight. And anyone that wants to do that can do it. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen?
Amen?
So here's the full extent of salvation and what we need to do. We need to believe in our heart. We need to proclaim it as, yes, I believe Jesus is Lord. He's my Savior. And in that instant, the Bible says that you're sealed by the Spirit as a son and child of God. So, in conclusion of that section there, everyone must believe in the good news about Jesus to be saved. Everyone.
Amen.
So here's the question for you. Do you believe? Have you put your faith and trust in Jesus? Do you know him as your Savior and Lord?
Amen.
Has there been a point in your life where you said, I understand I'm a sinner. I understand I'm going the wrong way. I need to turn around and go to God. And the only one that's going to be able to make me do that is Jesus. He went to the cross for me.
Amen.
He died for me. He shed his blood for me. I am forgiven because of him.
Amen.
And I believe that. And God raised him from the grave. And if I put my faith and trust in him, he's going to fill me with his Spirit. He's going to stamp his stamp of approval on me as a child of God. Have you done that? If not, please do that today. Today is the day of salvation for you, if you're willing to do that. So let's ask ourselves another question. What is the role of the Holy Spirit in salvation? What's the Holy Spirit's role in salvation? We know what we have to do when we hear the message is by faith believe and receive it. But now the big question is, when we come to that place, what is the Holy Spirit doing? How is he working? Well, notice what Paul says in verse 14. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. Now, that's typical Paul writing. It's long and involved. It has all kinds of modifying sentences, and it's very complex. So let's break it down and see what he's saying there. The first thing he says is this: the Holy Spirit authenticates our salvation. The Holy Spirit authenticates our salvation. And he puts it this way: when you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You were marked. There was a seal stamped on you. The Holy Spirit guaranteed that you really were a child of God. He authenticates that you are indeed in God's family now. Now, the word he uses there, seal, would have been understood in that time, because when they sent letters, say an edict came from a king, or say there was a legal document that was sent out, or say there was a message that had to be proclaimed in the marketplace, they would roll the scroll up, and they would put some wax where the scroll ended, and they would seal it together to hold that scroll together. And that seal made sure the thing was kept together, but it also was a stamp that marked who sent it. It was a stamp that said, this is sincere, this is true, this is genuine. I'm the one that sent it, and here's my mark to prove it. Okay, so what Paul's saying is that you and I, when we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are sealed by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the seal. What's that mean? It means you receive the Holy Spirit. He comes into your life. And at that moment, you are guaranteed, you are authenticated, you are declared genuine as God's child. Now, try to think of it in modern terms. If the seal equals genuineness or authenticity, think what happens when you have a legal document to sign. What do they say? They say you need to sign the document. You need some witnesses. And who else do you need? You need a notary public. Any notary publics in here? Got one back there, and one here. Okay. And the notary public has a seal. And the seal usually comes in one of those little clamp things, doesn't it? Kind of clamps it together. Or you have a stamp. And what the notary public does is they witness the signatures, and then they put the seal on it. And that verifies that, yes, these people wrote this document, they signed this document, and that it is genuine. So we still have that today, don't we? And that's what God does with us. When you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, He marks you with His seal. He says, this is the genuine item. This really is a child of God. This person is a part of my family. You want to stand up and say, thank you, God? Come on, stand up and say, thank you, God. You do that? All right. They're going to call us holy rollers here in a little bit. Okay? I think that's something to shout about. Amen? I am sealed with the seal of God, and the seal is the Holy Spirit. He's been given to me. He's in my life. Think in terms of, I used to work for a granary in Fort Worth when I was going to seminary. It was one of the best jobs I've ever had in my whole life. Okay? Not that this isn't a bad job. But they would bring those old grain trucks in, filled with grain, and we'd climb up in there. We had this pole, and it was made of brass and had a little opening at the bottom. You stamp it down there. You twist it. You take it back in to the man, and he would take samples of the grain, authenticate what kind of grain it was, and then he would ship it on to the next step, which would be to get that to be sent out on the rail line. And so once they got that grain transferred to the rail yard and the rail cars, somebody would come along, and they would put this little strip of metal or strip of sealing on it, and they would clamp it together. And that seal said, this is the real deal. This grain has been inspected and approved. It's been weighed, and it's ready to ship. It's ready to go. And that seal authenticated it. If the seal wasn't there, no one could trust the grain. If the seal was broken, they would raise questions about whether that had been stolen or abused in some way. The seal was very important to have. When Satan comes along, he looks to see if you're sealed. He wants to see if you're the real deal. And if he doesn't see the seal there, you're open game. He can rob you blind. He can attack you. He can use you as a way to fool others because you're not sealed. You see, the seal guarantees, it authenticates. It makes sure that you really are the real deal. So, Paul says, when you believed, you were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Now notice, it's the promised Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a person, and He is personal. The Holy Spirit is a person, and He's personal. He's the third person or persona of the Trinity. And he's part of the Godhead. And Father, Son, and Spirit are together in one union, and they commune, and they are one God with one purpose in mind. And the Holy Spirit is part of that. And he deals with us in a personal way. Now, Paul says he's the promised Holy Spirit. He's not an it. He's not a force. He's the promised one who is to come. It was prophesied in the Old Testament. Joel 2:28 said that one day the Spirit would be given and poured out. And then it happened on the day of Pentecost, didn't it? In Acts, remember, chapter 2, the same verses from Joel were quoted. Jesus himself said, I have to be taken back up to the Father, but I'm going to send to you a comforter, the paraclete. I'm going to send to you the one who is my Spirit. And he's going to come and be in you. And so it happened on the day of Pentecost. The Spirit was poured out. The promised one came. And as a result of that, each person that believed in the Lord Jesus, that day when Peter preached and they accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, as their Messiah, something happened. The Spirit came into their lives and they were transformed from the inside out. And something new happened in this world. Something that had never happened before. Holy Spirit indwelt all who believe in Jesus as Lord and Savior. So it was a personal fulfillment. It was a Pentecostal fulfillment. But notice, even though we don't live in the day of Pentecost anymore, that day's gone, we do live right now. And every time someone puts their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus, guess what happens? They have their own personal Pentecost. The Holy Spirit comes into their life. They're transformed. They're renewed. They're born again. That's what the Holy Spirit does. This promised Holy Spirit. You were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. He is the seal. He's the one that authenticates you. So how does He seal us? What's He do? Well, the Holy Spirit seals us in a very special way. How does He do that? First thing He does is He indwells us. He indwells us. Jesus said, I'll pour out my Spirit upon you, and He will be in you, and I in Him. Amen. And all of us in the Father. We're all intertwined together. We become part of the divine nature. We share the divine nature with God through His Spirit. Amen. You say, well, I don't know about that. I don't feel very divine. You don't have to feel divine at all. The Spirit of God lives in you. That makes you part of His Godhead. That makes you part of who He is. That makes you part of His family line. You're born again. That's the second thing. He empowers us. Acts 1:8. Jesus said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. So when the Holy Spirit comes and lives inside of you, He gives you the power to live this life. Now, I don't know about you. I get pretty tired sometimes. I get pretty weary. I get pretty discouraged. Don't you? Anybody want to admit that? All right, you get beat up a lot. You get beat up by people. You get beat up by life. You get beat up by the world around you. It just happens. But we can always go to the Father and kneel and say, Lord, the Holy Spirit who lives in me, let Him give me the power to deal with this situation. Give me the power to relate to people. Give me the power to overcome the problems in this world, the temptations of life, all the turmoil that we see around us. Fill me with Your Spirit. Empower me to do what You want me to do. And suddenly, there's a renewal. There's an uplifting. There's a filling. And you're able to deal with those things in ways that you never thought possible. Now, last night, I'm sitting there in the living room, and I've got the shooting pain down the back of my neck. It's going right here. It's going all the way down my arm. I wasn't having a heart attack. All right? And it's been bothering me all week because I had this crick in my neck. And so this morning I wake up, and guess what? It was still there. Okay? And so I did what you would do. I took 3 ibuprofen, and then I prayed, Lord, take away this pain. I don't have any pain right now at all. Okay?
Amen.
Now, I guarantee, as soon as I get home and start lunch, that pain's going to come back. All right? But that's what you have to do. You go on in the power of the Holy Spirit. It's something supernatural. We either believe that or we don't.
Amen.
If you don't, then why are you a Christian? Just go out there and live the way the world does. But if you're different, the Spirit of God lives in you, then start living like a supernatural Christian.
Amen?
Amen? Amen. The Holy Spirit's a person. He's personal. He seals us. He indwells us. He empowers us. But he also regenerates us. He regenerates us. Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. You must be born again. You have to have a spiritual birth that takes place inside of you. This is called regeneration. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. It is where Christ comes in us through his Spirit. And that happens to everyone who puts their faith and trust in Jesus. But there's also another aspect of salvation the Holy Spirit's a part of. He also baptizes us. He baptizes us. You've all been baptized into one Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. So what happens here? Well, he regenerates us. Christ comes and lives within us. But he also baptizes us into Christ. So we're part of his body now. And so we're made part of him. You see, it all works together. He lives in us. We live in him. And guess who does all that work? The Holy Spirit. He's the one that does it. He baptizes us and makes us one in Christ. So that's what it means when it says the Holy Spirit seals us, because he is the seal. So let's go on to the final part of this passage this morning. The Holy Spirit guarantees our salvation. The Holy Spirit guarantees our salvation. Now, we already said he authenticates it. He verifies it. He says that's true.
Amen.
But now he's going to guarantee it. He's going to say, guess what? This salvation you have, it's going to stay true all the time. It's going to last. It's going to keep on going. Okay? So hold on here. Listen to what he says. The promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. All right, so this same promised Holy Spirit, he's a deposit who guarantees our inheritance. So let's go back and kind of break that down again and ask ourselves, what is it that Paul is talking about here? Well, the first thing he's talking about is, he says, it's a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are, what? God's possession. So this seal is a sign of ownership. It's a sign of ownership. We are God's possession. He owns us. He owns us. You know, Christians that say, I can smoke marijuana recreationally, they're making a decision there based upon the idea that I can do that. Have you considered asking the one who owns you what you can do?
Amen.
For those who involve themselves with prostitutes, like Paul was dealing there with people in Corinth, he asked them that question. You all say, I'm free to do whatever I want. I can eat what I want. I can sleep with whomever I want. Paul says, don't you know that your body is not your own anymore?
Amen.
That you are the temple of the Holy Spirit?
Yes, sir. Good.
You got other decisions to make now. It's not about what you want. It's not about pleasing you.
Right.
Now you have to consider, what does he want?
Amen.
With my body? What does he want me to do with my life? You see? We are his possession. And so the Holy Spirit is a sign that we are owned by him. It's a sign of ownership. Now, out west, where they have these big cattle ranches, many times they'll bring them in, like when I used to live in Fort Worth, they bring them into the stockyard, downtown Fort Worth, and they bring all these cows in. And they put them all in this big old corral in this fenced-in area. And all these cows from different ranchers would come in there. And they're all mixed together and so on. And the question arises, how do they know whose cow belongs to whom? How do they know? Well, each ranch has its own seal, doesn't it? Each cow is branded with the ranch's name. And so all they had to do was check the brand on the back of the cow, and they knew that that belonged to that rancher. And so it didn't matter if they're all out there in the pen together. When they started shuttling in through the chutes, all they had to do was look at the brand. This is so-and-so, weighs such-and-such, ship it out to here. And it was very easy to identify because they had the brand, the seal of ownership on the back. Now, when you receive the Holy Spirit, that's God's seal of ownership, that He owns you. You are His possession from this time on. 2 Corinthians 1:22, it says this: He anointed us, set His seal of ownership on us, and put His Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Can't make it much clearer than that, can you? Can't make it much clearer than that. But also, the seal is a sign of eternal security. It's a sign of eternal security. And this is very important. We need to know that we're God's, and we're going to be God's forever. It's going to be, we're going to be part of His family from this time on and forevermore. Notice what he says up there. He's a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's inheritance. In Ephesians 4:30, Paul says it this way: Do not grieve the Holy Spirit, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. What's the day of redemption? The day of redemption is when all this ends. When everything concludes. And finally His family is brought into His home. And everything is drawn together. That's the day of redemption. The final day. And so what he's saying here is, you were sealed for that day. It lasts. It's guaranteed from now until then. Okay, that's forever. Very clear statement of eternal security. Now, you say, well, what difference does it make? Well, I don't know around here, but when I was in southeastern Ohio, there was a lot of holiness teaching going on. And the holiness teaching taught this, that, yeah, you can be saved by the Lord Jesus, and you have to have faith, and you have to have God's grace, but by golly, you better hold on. If you sin in any kind of way, if you mess up, you're going to lose your salvation. So you better be sure you're walking in holiness all the time. Because if you don't, you're going to lose your salvation. And so it was terrible to go to people's homes and I'd say, you know, what's your relationship with Christ? Well, I used to be a Christian. What do you mean you used to be a Christian? Well, I received Jesus, my Lord and Savior, and He forgave my sins. He came into my life, but I messed up. You know, I had a divorce, or I committed this sin, or I began drinking, and I lost my salvation. And it's very frustrating to get those people to understand that, yeah, they may have sinned, and yeah, they may have drifted for a while, but if you really were born again, if you really were sealed by the Spirit, you're not going to lose your salvation. Because, what do we say? It's by grace you were saved through faith. Grace isn't grace if I have to keep working for it. It's either grace or it's not grace. It's either grace or works. Amen. Now, this came home this past week to me because I had a relative call me, and she was all bent out of shape. She thought, I don't know if I'm saved. I'm going, what are you talking about? You've been saved since you were a little girl. You've taught in Sunday school. You've been working in the church for years. You play the piano. You sing. You've been a vibrant Christian all these years. But there was a time in her life when she went through a very terrible emotional experience in her marriage. And she had a divorce. And after the divorce, she did what a lot of people do. They have the rebound. And they go out there and they start seeing whomever they want to see. And they start sleeping whomever they want to sleep. And so that was a time in her life as well. But God woke her up and brought her back. And she repented. And she got back in church. And she's been living with the Lord from that time on. some preacher told her, well, you were never really a Christian because you wouldn't have done those things if you were a Christian. And so from that point, her spirit just went like that. Am I really a Christian or not? And so I had to spend all week pointing her to scriptures that point out that once you're secured by the Holy Spirit in Christ, you can't lose your salvation. Can you mess up? Amen. I've done it. Have you? By the way, I did it today. I messed up today. I got angry. I sinned. Did I lose my salvation? Then what makes you think divorce makes you lose salvation? Or having an affair makes you lose your salvation? A sin's a sin's a sin. It's either all sin that's cleansed by the blood of Jesus, or no sin at all. So I told her, I said, look, the very fact that you feel worried about this and guilty about this shows that you really are a child of God. Because in Hebrews 12 it says that God disciplines those he loves. If you're not being disciplined, if you're not grieving over your sin, if the Holy Spirit's not convicting you, that means you're not really his child at all. So I said, for the very fact that you're worried about this shows you are a child of God.
Amen.
You see, that's what the Holy Spirit does. He makes sure we stay in the family. He doesn't want any of his children running out there in the world. And so if you go out there and you stray from the Lord, he's going to slap you down and bring you back. Okay? Now that may sound very harsh and crude, but I speak from experience, all right? He slapped me down and he brought me back. All right? And it wasn't fun. And I don't want to do it again. Okay? The Holy Spirit seals us. That's why we shouldn't grieve him. We don't need to grieve him. We need to walk with him and live in him and just allow him to use us and bring glory to God. Well, notice, the seal is a sign of ownership. It's a sign of eternal security. But finally, the seal is a down payment on our inheritance. It's a down payment on our inheritance. Paul says that he is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance. This word deposit is very important. It means it's a pledge. It means it's a down payment. If you put a deposit on a house, that says, I'm signing a contract. I want to buy that house. And here's my deposit. Here's my surety that I'm going to follow through with the contract and buy that house. If you decide not to buy that house, you got to go through a lot of difficulty to get out of that, don't you, Gene? Okay? It's very difficult because the deposit's been laid down there. It's saying, I'm going to buy this house. Here is evidence. I'm going to put the deposit down, the down payment. Now, that means that later on I'm going to buy it in full once the loan clears. Okay? Well, that's what God does with us. He gives us the down payment of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is God's way of saying, look, you enjoy the fruit of the Spirit now, love, peace, joy, kindness, gentleness. You enjoy that fruit of the Spirit in your life that the Holy Spirit brought to you. Guess what? That's just a down payment of what's to come.
Amen.
That's just a small down payment of everything that waits you in glory.
Amen?
Amen? And so, when we look at this deposit, this down payment, we can be sure that God is going to carry out what he has promised to each and every one of us. The word itself used to be used for an engagement ring, where the husband-to-be would put the engagement ring on and he would say, I'm going to marry you, and here's proof, here's the deposit, here's the ring to show that I mean business. That's what God's done with us, with the Holy Spirit. He's given us his Spirit to live within us, to produce his fruit, so we know that from now until forever, we'll be his child. Well, let me just close with the final line. The Holy Spirit makes us children of God. He marks us as children of God, and he maintains us as children of God until we enter God's eternal home. Amen? Now, do you have that security? Do you know that's a fact in your own life? Has the Holy Spirit made you a child of God? Has he marked you? Do you have that assurance of salvation that you are God's child forever? If not, my friend, listen, make it right today. We just sang earlier, Holy Spirit, rain down. Well, the rain's falling, okay? The rain's coming down. But the Holy Spirit's here, and He's drawing you. He's saying, come, come, come. Give your life to Jesus. Let me enter your life and make you a child of God. Let's stand together. We're going to close this song this morning. You come as we sing. God's Spirit is speaking to you. Only you know what He's saying to your heart. You come, and you share with us what God is doing by His Holy Spirit.